journalist.
Yeah.
I can share. I have experience from both sides. More than 30 years I worked as a journalist. A couple of 3-4 years I worked with a corporate in Chhattisgarh. So I had inside of corporate. As far as Salwa Judung is concerned, my opinion is just like what happened to Anand Mark, just like happened to all those powers who the communist forces in India, who find them real challenge. They have been always given a bad name. Salwa Judung is exactly that exercise. Salwa Judung was given a bad name when it became popular in Chhattisgarh. Local media was not reporting, but the communist propaganda machine, they worked full time in overdrive to give a bad name to Salwa Judung. You see all the reports which have come out against Salwa Judung, every single report has been drafted and written by the communist propagandists. Now it is something that in India, the media is also very convenient. Most of us would not go to Chhattisgarh to probe the things. Most of us will buy from the hands of propagandists. Salwa Judung, I wish somebody writes a book.
That is why Supreme Court also disbanded.
Can you, sir?
Because they are also influenced by the
That is perception.
That is
this
why
is exactly.
They also influenced.
Yeah, you proved it. You proved it.
Yeah, you know, we are getting political. Can we stick to journalism?
You know, it is perception. And this propaganda machine has been able, very successful, I salute them in this exercise of success, that even they could reach Supreme Court.
Thank you. Any other question? This is getting highly political and volatile.
Yes.
Yeah, please.
Please.
They were talking about the unpaid salaries in India, about 90% are unpaid. Same is the case in Pakistan. The same scenario, same district. The reporters and correspondents didn't get paid.
Can you be a bit more?
So, when I started using social media as a journalist, I thought this is the best platform to highlight journalist community's issues. Like someone is getting paid, or someone is not getting paid, or the issues of journalist communities, which mainstream media do not highlight or publish, something like that. There is a recent example that a female reporter usually tried to commit suicide because she was unpaid for the last 3 months, and she was in depression or something like that. I got the news, I put it on Twitter. Within 3 or 4 hours, they called her in the office and paid her 3 months' salary. But what happened after that to me, that's another story. So,
do you still have your job?
Sir,
okay, good. Any other question? Yeah, please.
Actually, I think what you raised initially, who is journalist and how journalism has changed. Let me give you one example, which is globally debated.
Are you a journalist?
I'm a journalism teacher. I worked in the Institute of Mass Communication. Glenn Greenwald was written a story in Guardian, and Edward Snowden supplied information to Glenn Greenwald. Do you treat Glenn Greenwald as a journalist and Edward Snowden as whistleblower? That is my question to all of you. That will redefine journalism.
Yeah, please.
I would like to elaborate how that tweet of Osama bin Laden came out. Because how did the guy who tweeted know that this place was of Osama bin Laden? I think
he didn't tweet about Osama. He said there is action happening.
Yeah, there is some action happening. There is some gunship helicopter with a usual site. I'm sure not even there. But a gunship helicopter with a lot of marines like Hollywood
TV. It happens now and then.
So that's why people reported about that, and I'm hearing a lot of noise about there is probably a bombshell, there is probably some gunshots hearing. So that tweet basically got out from Aftabad, and especially because that place was like in the sensitive areas, and so that got like, once it got on Twitter, then a couple of other people also tweeted about it, and that's how it spread. And then essentially I would agree with Gautam here, because even if the Twitter is definitely there, but in Pakistan, just as I mentioned, there are around 1.8 million users. But still, until and unless the mainstream media, of course there are social media successes as well, independently, like there is a certain story which has become so popular that the, just like the OBL raid, the Osama bin Laden raid, it is so popular, so important that...
Can I ask you another question? Where does your government play on this? I mean, look, they banned YouTube, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
The ban is still on. How do you people like manage? I mean, you know...
proxies.
Any other question? You have a question, sir?
I want the distinguished panel to talk a bit about the leave aside the information use of the social media. When it comes to the political use of social media, how the state structure comes in, like how state censors the political use of social
media. It's a very large subject in itself. I want to restrict it to journalism in this particular session.
Right.
But I'm sure any of our panelists would be more than delighted to have an offline discussion.
No,
yes, ma'am.
When we talk about journalism and the social media, it is important to talk about the structure that the internet is taking today. Like the multimedia nature of stories. Like there are links. Like when you can watch a video, you can see the audio, you can read the text, you can go past past story, read future reports, read present reports. So the structure is changing when of reading news, of consuming news, and of producing news. So like that also needs to be.
Sajid, you want to comment?
Yeah. So if I get you right, what you're saying is there is a news item which you're reading.
Multimedia nature of the news.
So let's look at that news, and it says, what's the related news? So if you're discussing a particular subject, so they'll say, what are the developments that have happened over the last few days, last few months on that particular subject? And very often within the text of the story, you would have bold URLs where you can say what happened, who said what, etc., etc. So the whole issue really is that really is not journalism. That's a challenge to the medium to say, can I keep this reader hooked to my site for X number of minutes, X page views, etc., etc., so that a few seconds later, when I serve a particular ad, this guy gets to see it. So that's the way of their retaining the reader.
I'll have a slightly different view on this.
Sure.
I think what she's talking about and which you are saying gets the ad, and which is also true, is actually really a contextualization of a particular information. Where, for instance, if you look at the Delhi gang rape judgment, so there was the reported part, and immediately, I think the first organization that I saw give a link to the whole judgment was Outlook, but there could have been some others as well. And I dropped everything and I went and read the judgment. Does it mean that it is not journalism? I don't know. It gave me a context. Pikyar, what do you think?
Social media ke aane se...
Ek shan, sir. Ek minute. Abhi aapke paas aata. What do you think?
I fully agree with you. In fact, I had a couple of points also on this.
Yeah.
But maybe you want to just close.
Haan, sir. Like bataiye.
सोशल मीडिया के आने से परंपरागत मीडिया को क्या चुनौतियां मिली हैं, उसका असर क्या है, उसका प्रभाव क्या है?
Okay, so I can just, in fact, I had a point, maybe this will also address this a little bit. So there's this project that we spoke about briefly in the first session that I'm involved with. It's a BBC project called Digital Indians. Now the story is incidental. We're profiling various digital Indians, including people like Shubhranshu, who are doing great work on the digital empowerment front and so on. The point is, it's a multimedia, cross-platform, social media-led program, which is very unusual for a large media organization like the BBC. There are severe challenges. Okay, and now on one side, the BBC is actually very ahead of the curve in terms of its electronic media use. On the other side, it's extremely careful about what it publishes. So just to give you an example, I'm tweeting, I'm operating the BBC India Twitter account. But, there's a second pair of eyes and a third pair of eyes in London. Okay, the second pair of eyes is sitting here. So now I've got to the stage where I am tweeting it live, but there is somebody watching. Now, there was a recent case where there was a senior BBC journalist who tweeted, there was a little news item about an explosion which killed some people. And he said most of them were civilians. Okay, that was a factual error. And he tweeted on the go minutes after that explosion happened and people were killed. It turned out that was completely wrong. Now it was a
apparently a small error, but he's in fairly serious trouble. Because what the BBC says is that what you tweet should have the same credibility as what you put on air in a newscast. Now, this is a problem. I mean, I fundamentally disagree with this. Okay, this is, you're taking old media thinking and trying to put it on social media. But on the other hand, I understand where this is coming from, because there's a media brand involved. And you know, you're saying that, okay, what you're tweeting out, it might be an individual journalist, but he's carrying the BBC handle. So this is a real, conundrum and a kind of a divergence which we haven't really been able to find.
But I would agree with it. If you're a BBC journalist or a journalist from any other newspaper, you cannot just randomly say what you have to, because you have to do your fact checking. You need to ensure that what you're writing is correct, which any other person is free to do. That pardon? Absolutely, and particularly, and therefore, that is, in my opinion, is what distinguishes journalism from a journalist tweeting and a Twitter in general.
Yeah, so absolutely. The only thing is, it totally slows down the conversation in terms of what you.
That's a price we need to pay.
It's a price.
Sir,
my point is that journalism gets its power from right to speak and expression.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
My point is that journalism gets its power, especially from as far as our constitution is concerned, journalism gets its power from right to speech and expression, Article 19(1)(a). Now, as far as the social media is concerned, the question is about the right to speech and expression. We are giving the power to the normal consumers. So why there is that much, what the trouble in that?
As an individual, you are free to write whatever you wish to in whatsoever manner, as long as it is not blasphemous, as long as it's not libelous, because you can be taken to task for those laws which in any case operate online or off. But when you say that you are a journalist tweeting, there are certain expectations out of a journalist. Like I mentioned, anybody can give you a discipline if you have a headache. That doesn't make you a doctor.
But that person is having the power, and that person is having the right to express himself. So we should give our right now the social media.
I think that expression is there.
Gautam, this question is important, because journalists get certain protection. And if suppose any citizen is writing something on his blog, and if suppose he is using some sources, you can protect as a journalist source. But should a common citizen can protect his sources? That is the question related to Glenn Greenwald. And that is why it's important. If you are not treating common citizens as journalists, then they may not be able to get certain protection. And they may get arrested every time. Writing on Facebook or social media.
I don't think journalists get any additional protection.
They get protection. They get protection in US.
Yeah.
To protect their sources.
Yes, sir. No, there it's by law. I think journalism is protected far greater way than it is.
Yes.
Barely audible, sir.
The kind of political economy which you have tried to highlight in terms of ownership of media, and print media and television media both have maintained their hegemony on information regime, and this social media has actually challenged this regime, and. We are assuming that social media is a democratic space. So, do you think that there is very much resistance from this hegemonic traditional media to this democratic space not to allow and not to be challenged by them? And that is why I feel that they do not allow so much. We don't have it.
This social media pe sabse bada question ye hai.
To jawab dene dijiye
abhi. I will come back to the same example of Salwa Judum. So everybody knew about it. They were deliberately not reporting. So others picked it up. Internet gives us an opportunity. The news was first local, then national, then international. This news was first picked up by international, then it became national. So it's topsy-turvy thanks to social media.
Would you like to take that question?
Maybe we will get his question.
Okay. Sorry, ma'am. Didn't hear that.
Then that there is room for both to coexist, like the traditional journalism
something. Absolutely. In a lot of newsrooms, those Twitter trends.
Left side pe jo aata hai. that is what is driving the main news. You will see, or you will see a lot of stories which happen on the Twitter, trending in Twitter, and which goes out there. 1 minute, ma'am. Yes, sir. आप कुछ कह रहे थे? ये last 3 questions, please.
Social media पर सबसे बड़ा सवाल ये उठता है कि इसकी authenticity की समस्या है. जो परंपरागत media है, वहाँ पर तो प्रमाणिकता की कोई समस्या नहीं है, क्योंकि journalist
कोई समस्या नहीं है.
कोई भी report करता है, तो verification करता है. सोशल मीडिया में सबसे बड़ी समस्या है कि मैंने किसी का फोटो लिया और तुरंत डाल दिया. किसी के बारे में कुछ भी लिखना है मेरे को, तुरंत लिख दिया, तब तक तो उसकी पूरी 12 बज गई, उसकी इज्जत जो है ना वो पूरी चली गई. लेकिन सोशल मीडिया पे इसका कोई समाधान नहीं है.
पत्रकारिता में भी कहा.
Yes, ma'am, you were asking.
I would just like to add to what both of them said. I think that as journalists, for example, I was there, I covered the Delhi gang rape case, I was there in and out for the reportage. I think that the Twitter, the Facebook, I think we as journalists need to, you know, critically examine the feeds, the tweets that come in, because we are there on the spot. And the movement basically sort of, the black dot movement, it sort of, you know, took shape on the internet. Okay, and the reality and what was happening on the virtual medium, it was basically two parallel realities. And I think that we as journalists need to basically critically examine what feeds we are getting. There were inputs that came into journalists that, you know, that the police is beating up people, women, they were being beaten up at the Parliament Street. But do we report it just taking feeds? We need to verify and then recheck. And at the same time, we get feeds like, you know, Imran Hashmi dead all of a sudden on Facebook and it getting viral. And agencies like, at times, INS picking up news, even though they have dedicated desks for Twitter and all these accounts.
I think that's, you're pointing to the disruptive nature of this whole medium, and I think we're still exploring it right now. Anyone, last question?
See, I completely agree with you that social media needs to be responsible. So what we do in CG Net's work, every single message is cross-checked and verified. We get around 50 messages a day, we release 5. So we need to be responsible. But what we are talking about, this cross-checking is done by us in a democratic manner. 50 of us, we choose 5 of us our
moderator. We can't choose who is Times of India ka editor hai. So that's the model we are talking about. We should get responsible that what you are reporting, I should be talking to you. Why are you putting something which is nonsense? So it's a democratization of communication what we are talking about. Nobody is justifying anybody putting out anything in public. If we are 50 people sitting here, if I start talking nonsense, you will all stop me. That's what should come from community. Not, yeah.
Now, out of this entire debate, the question is, there is journalism. As our friend said, that there is a disciplined journalism, there is training, there are counter-checks, there are many steps of verifying, counter-checking, and then the information goes out. The other is social media, where everybody has the freedom. It's democracy, I respect it. But then why do we want to call them also journalists? Why do we want to expand the definition of journalism? Let it be information on social media, which is right or wrong is one thing, but they have democratic right to say something. That we should respect. But I don't think the social media or whatever is being said on that should be given the respectability of journalism. Do you think?
Thank you. One last question, anybody from the back bench? Yeah.
There's one on your left.
Sorry. Oh, sorry. Okay. I'll just make it plain. Yeah. Little louder, please.
My name is Aarti.
And stop calling his backbenchers.
It seems to have a connotation that isn't so positive. Okay, I'm sorry. I'll try and be as loud as I can. I have a little bit of a cold. So we've been talking. My name is Aarti. I belong to an organization called The Alternative from Bangalore. We are an online publication talking about sustainability and social impact. So we've been talking a little bit about the process of journalism and how social media has started to change the way we process stories and how we develop them. I had a question about the consumption of content. I mean, so today social media and the regular traditional news coexist together. We have breaking news on Twitter, then it develops on Facebook. The first set of, I mean, probably first post will have an article out in the next hour, you know, and then it's developed slowly, and then the Hindu will have a one-page op-ed the next day, and so on, you know. So there could be, so, and there is merit in getting like that 140 character byte to just know what's happened, and then the story developing slowly, and then being able to also get diverse viewpoints and some food for thought. my question probably to Sanjeev and the rest of the distinguished panelists. Is social media also making us satisfied with the instant gratification of news that we're getting, you know? Is that then making journalism, which is more reflective and deeper, irrelevant, or I mean, towards the path of irrelevance?
Absolutely. I think instant gratification is really the biggest payoff of social media. Just imagine if I was to write a piece which to a newspaper. It has to get into a queue. I have to keep waiting for it to appear or not appear at all at the end of 7 days. Whereas if I have a blog of my own, I can post it on the blog, I can tweet it, I can put it on the Facebook, I can put it on my LinkedIn pages, and it can, if it is worthy enough, it can sort of get in everywhere.
Where you wanted it?
Yeah, I also want to comment on it because this is no, I mean, there is no denying of the fact, because just as he just mentioned in the previous session, that a street boy who is earning probably 60, 70 rupees a day is going to be spending more on access to internet than he spends on food maybe. So it is actually about probably some gratification that probably street boy is earning so little, and probably everybody who is on social media is gets after like tweeting something about. But here I think we should like focus a little bit on journalism, because that gratification you get whenever you put up a display picture and you earn 130 likes immediately. This is also giving you gratification. I personally would agree with this gentleman that I have no problem with it. But when it comes to journalism, the authenticity of news, that is, I would say that the traditional media houses are actually adapting to the changing environment. For example, I have been told by the newspaper that we are an online first now. So whatever you have to file, you can like immediately send it to us using your mobile phone. We have to follow tweets. Whenever we get a tip, as you just mentioned, the story gets developed, and by the end of night or during the deadline, it goes online immediately. You see it in the print edition tomorrow, next day, and then we have got an application as well for iPhone, for internet, for Blackberries even. So in that, it is going to appear differently. On Facebook, it is going to appear differently. It is going to be just an image with the person who is saying something with a bold text, and people are sharing it on Facebook. The structure, there is somebody here who was mentioning about the structure of the social media. So that is also changing, and the traditional media houses are adapting to these changes, and they are issuing these instructions to their journalists. But yes, at the end of the day, I agree with that gratification part, definitely. And
I would just like to add my one little bit, half a bit actually, that apart from gratification, I think Twitter or 140 characters also allows us to debate instantly. So such and such thing has happened, I said this is not nice, or somebody says this is not good, and somebody says this is a context, and for the reporter it's very good because he gets a ready-made story almost ready to go. Last question, please.
Actually, I don't know if it is a question. Actually, I'm from Nepal and I'm in journalism back in Nepal. And being a Nepali journalist, I don't have very good English, but still I try to communicate, because I've heard here so many discussions, but I have got some positive impact of social media on traditional journalism. So I want to share this information. Last year there was program plan of UN Secretary General to visit Nepal, and there was news all over. But suddenly, the head of UNDP, he was Robert Piper, he just put this information in his social media, his Facebook and Twitter account, that the plan has been postponed for now. And then all the journalists, they put that information from that site, and then they spread it. And even the mainstream daily newspaper, they give the credit to his account. One is that. Another one is, nowadays, even our mainstream daily newspaper editor, they has got Facebook and Twitter account, and they have started saying that whatever they wrote in their newspaper, they put in their Facebook and Twitter account, saying that my take on this event. And then people, they start like commenting on it, so it becomes more clear, and you know, that kind of thing. So can I continue?
Quickly, please.
Okay, and even our ex-Prime Minister, Bhavram Bhattarai, he is the person who has got most Twitter followers within our country, and he started communicating directly to the people regarding the news and other things as well, and that is also the thing we are getting now. Since we have more than 10% of our population, they are using Facebook now. It is getting the scenario is getting different. For example, for me, I used to work for the largest daily newspaper in Nepal, which is Kantipur, and the English version is Cartoon Post. But 5 years ago, we all resigned, all including the editors of both Kantipur and Cartoon Post, because of differences between management and editorial team. And there was nowhere to go. Then we started online news portal, which was Dainiki.com. And that time, all the big houses, they were not focused on online news portal. So when we started, within 15 days, our online news portal became the biggest like visiting site in Nepal, within 15 days. And then another publisher came to us, and we all went to that publication and that publisher. And within 3 years, that publisher, that publication house called, they published Nepali in Nagrik and English Republika. And that publication house became second largest influential media in our country. And then again, there was differences between editorial team and management. So we all again resigned, and including editor of both daily newspaper. And we all again came outside.
Thank you.
And
thanks.
Then we started again news portal just 5 months ago, and this time the competition is a little bit tough because they also started investing on it. So the main thing is how we get success is, because that time people used to say that is the significant difference between the other newsroom and your newsroom is all the people in your newsroom use actively use Facebook, and now people they say all the people in your newsroom, you use Facebook and Twitter, and you interact with your reader. That is the difference. So now we are the fourth most visited website
Thank
in
you.
Nepal.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, any more questions?
Can I take 2 minutes?
Okay, great. I think we are through. We are through with the time.
I know I am stopping you from lunch, but he asked me about radio, that how is radio not free in this country. See, there is a proverb called there is no free lunch where we are going now. There is no free lunch. Somebody is paying. So the media we have today is actually free. It's not free of that time. See, to produce one newspaper, it costs more than 100 rupees. Which we produce in 2 rupees, which we buy in 2 rupees. So somebody is paying that 98 rupees. That's what we must always think. On radio, it is banned in this country. What we need is shortwave radio, which nobody can do but Government of India. What we need is medium wave, that nobody can do but All India Radio. 65 years after our independence, who are, you know, biggest democracy, first democracy, we should be shaming India in international platforms. We want to become a United Nations Security Council member. I mean, Pakistan recently, Noam Chomsky had written that Pakistani media is more free than Indian media. Then somebody had reacted that Pakistani government does not really care because 1.5 lakh log to akhbar padte hain angrezi mein, usme kuch bhi likho. In the same way, we are world's biggest democracy. You can open a television station which has gone from 1 to 800. You can open as many newspapers as you want. But what matters in this country is radio, that still remains banned. You can open a community radio which goes 5 kilometers. In Chhattisgarh, hundreds of us have applied. I have wasted my 5 years in training people on how to do radio. How many applications got through, you know? Zero. It needs 32 permissions from Government of India to get our Agriculture University of Raipur. Their application was also cancelled. So in world's biggest democracy, we're afraid of people talking. That's the nature of communication. That's the free world we live in. So let's
on
go
that
and have
very optimistic
lunch.
Note, thank you very much.